Herb Schiller,
who is a professor at the University of California at San Diego, and the author of several books on communication issues, the most recent of which is Who Knows? Information in the Age of the Fortune 500. As we peruse the pages of the Times, it is important to remember that the Times is more than a newspaper. The New York Times is a large corporation, publishing newspapers in Florida, North Carolina, Louisiana, and the International Herald Tribune in Europe. It puts out magazines too, in the United States alone, Family Circle, Golf and Tennis, and trade magazines, as well as in Australia and Great Britain. It operates television stations in three key Sunbelt cities, Memphis, Tennessee, Huntsville, Alabama, and Fort Smith, Arkansas. All of these stations are CBS affiliates. The New York Times is also WQXR AM and FM here in New York City. The Times is expanding to cable TV, purchasing a multi-franchise system in southern New Jersey. The Times empire includes computer and data retrieval systems and two presses, Arno and Times Books, as well as several services for libraries, microfilms, and other teaching resources. During the year, the Times daily paper consumes 295,000 metric tons of paper. But don't worry, they won't run out of paper, because they own four Canadian paper mills, which produce 800,000 metric tons per year. In the last 5 years, the revenues of the Times have gone up some 65% to $733 million. The readers of the Times are doing well also. According to their corporate report, 68% of them earn more than $100,000 per annum. 48% of them have securities worth over $100,000. And, of course, they don't forget the truly deserving. Last year, readers contributed $1.2 million to the Neediest Cases Fund. The board of directors of the New York Times includes two bankers, George Shin, director of First Boston, one of the main banks used by the defense industry in New England. George is also president of Merrill Lynch, and has served as co-chairman of the Municipal Assistance Corporation, the so-called Big Mac, the banker's key to New York City. William Cross is vice president of Morgan Guaranty Trust and also a director of Amex, a Compton industry. There are two businessmen on that board, William May, former chairman of the American Can Company and a director of Bankers Trust and Engelhard Minerals and Chemicals, and Richard Gell, chairman of Bristol Myers, manufacturer of pharmaceuticals. He is also a director of the Bankers Trust Fund. There are two members on the Trilateral Commission who sit on the board of the New York Times. William Scranton, ex-governor of Pennsylvania, who is now a director of IBM, Bethlehem Steel, Scott Paper, and Sun Oil. He is also a member of the Council on Foreign Relations. And Cyrus Vance, former Deputy Secretary of Defense and also a former Secretary of State. There are four Salzburgers on the board of the New York Times: Arthur, Ruth, Judith, and Marion. Marion is the director of the Ford Motor Company and also Merck. Her husband, Andrew Heiskell, is chairman of Time Incorporated and has served as a director of Con Edison, our local nuclear industry. Arthur and his sisters own 38% of the New York Times stock. Cowles Communications owns another 22%. That indicates that although it is a so-called public company, 60% of the New York Times is controlled by two interests. 83.9% of their stock is owned by 24 holders. So let's take a look at the New York Times of today, October 28th, 1981, and just see what these people have found fit to print.
You've heard about the size, the importance of the New York Times as a media conglomerate. But you might also say, well, why just pick on the New York Times for an analysis, which we are going to be doing now and for the next several weeks? There are many other huge conglomerates. And the answer to that is yes, you could, just as maybe with great effect and illumination, look at the McGraw-Hill conglomerate, or you could be looking at Warner Amex or Westinghouse. But the New York Times occupies a very special place in American life and also in the life of the metropolitan New York area. Because the New York Times is a very special newspaper. The New York Times circulates in the center of the whole system of finance and international money making and property owning. The Times is what the decision makers read. The Times is the paper of record. That means it's supposed to. Doesn't always do this. In fact, it rarely does it. But it's supposed to be able to be looked at and have verbatim texts, to say nothing of what are any type of legitimate public statements. So it serves in that manner too. And then another crucial ingredient of the New York Times is that the stories that appear on its front pages invariably also appear as the lead stories in the newsrooms of the major three networks, ABC, CBS, and NBC. So the New York Times does in fact occupy a very, very special place. Now I think we have to recognize that there are other factors too in how the New York Times plays a special role. We have to understand that in the United States, there is no central command mechanism. For example, there's no permanent civil service where the same faces, regardless of who happens to be the existing policymakers, continue and have the same policies undertaken from decade to decade as exist in France or Great Britain. There's no state broadcasting systems. The big companies that exercise such enormous power in the United States nevertheless are all fighting amongst themselves for their own particular shares, their own particular kinds of dominance. So, for example, one big defense contractor may have its own general. Another defense contractor has its admiral. A third defense contractor may have a whole division of the Pentagon behind it. So there's a great deal of pull and a great deal of tug and a great deal of almost what you might call instability and chaos in this vast system of property. And somewhere there has to be a steering mechanism. Now, it would be too much to put on the shoulders of the New York Times that entire role as the steering mechanism of this vast system of property owning and property control and property decision, both domestically and internationally. But it does, to a certain degree, offer a great amount of, shall we say, fine-tuning in this operation. There are other steering mechanisms, to be sure, in the society, longer-term mechanisms. There is the school system, for example, all the way from the elementary to the university, which in a sense guarantees the fundamental assumptions and values and directions of the society. And in addition to the school system, there are the foundations, there are the corporations and their continuous pressures, there's the two-party system. All of these are longer-term mechanisms, but for the day-in and the day-out instruction of how things should be regarded, how policies should be initiated, are policies working well, what options might be adopted, what options might be disregarded, what options may be discarded. This is where a structure with the kinds of control possibilities that the New York Times exercises by virtue of its size, by virtue of its economic weight, by virtue of the position of the people who are on its directing board, by virtue of its geographical location, by virtue of the role it plays in the metropolitan center of our society. By all of these mechanisms, we find that the New York Times is particularly capable of providing that steering mechanism. Now, how does it do so? How does it go about and do all of these things that I'm talking about? Well, for the first thing, it acts in a very general way in terms of just setting forth what some kinds of policies might be in a shifting world, in a world where different conditions are changing all the time, where power relations are shifting, where 100 new countries have come into existence in the last 50 years. The New York Times set forth very often in its editorial columns, sometimes in its op-ed page, sometimes in the way the news is organized, certain kinds of possibilities, certain kinds of directions. Much more visible, however, is how the Times acts as the leading conduit for the policies that are adopted by the major policy-making decisions of the government and society. What has been passed in Congress, what has been presidentially determined, what are the roles and the positions taken by the Pentagon, what the State Department is enunciating. All of these various policies will be passed along almost in an open channel by the New York Times, by its correspondents, by its individuals who are either on assignment in Washington, or on assignment in the Pentagon, or on assignment at the State Department, or on assignment in the field, when their men are out, or, and I say men because they are almost entirely men, when their men are out in Moscow, we can be quite assured that these are not random selections. These are individuals who will be playing that role of passing along what the policies are. And then, of course, the Times has still another role in addition to serving as a conduit. It also operates very often as a continuous monitor. It monitors how these policies are going. And it will try to see if these policies are being effective. It will applaud them. It will continue them. It will keep the whole machine moving very smoothly on the course if those policies are doing what they were intended to do. But if by chance those policies are not effective, if those policies are not doing what they should be doing, here is where the Times comes in as a gentle prod, as a gentle suggester, as sometimes as a decision arbiter, suggesting other paths, indicating where things are going awry, and indicating what might be done to change these matters. And in all cases, always recognizing that the fundamental interests of the property-owning structure of this society and those who run this property-owning structure, that should be the consideration of last resort. And so we may say that the New York Times, if we may give it as any one central function, it is in its ultimate sense always, and I use the word always, which is a very, very tricky word to use because very few things are always. But the New York Times, we can say, always is concerned and always will be featuring the long-term interests as it determines them of this entire system. There will be occasions, of course, where this will come into collision with one or another sector's of powerful interests in the society. And at such occasions, sometimes there is confusion. But nevertheless, remember, it is the steering mechanism for the system overall and not for any one particular side of it. And now, after a very brief interruption, we'll come back and examine some of the very specific ways in which some of the general things I've said are undertaken.
Mother doesn't go out anymore. Just sits at home and rolls her spastic eyes. But every weekend through the door come words of wisdom from the world outside. If you wanna know about the bishop and an actress, if you wanna know how to be a star, if you wanna know about the stains on the mattress, you can read it in the Sunday papers. Sunday papers. Mother's wheelchair stays out in the hall. Why should she go out when the TV's on? Whatever moves beyond these walls, she'll know the facts when Sunday comes along. If you wanna know better, mad punk rockers, if you wanna know how to play guitar.
Point to them or what? Do I point to this thing? Let us examine two of the central questions that confront us as individuals, our nation, and the world. Two central questions upon which we can make any determination of how a source of information is behaving. One, the issue of nuclear war, avoiding nuclear war, and maintaining some kind of peace. And a second central consideration for any news vehicle would be, what are the standard of living conditions? What is the standard of life? What is the welfare of our population? Let us turn to the first issue, the issue of nuclear war and war avoidance. And let us take as our text today's New York Times, October 28th, and let us see a crucial question discussed in the columns of the New York Times, in three or four columns, for example. Let us point, for example, to the story of the AWACS, about which we have been hearing endless things and reading endless amounts of words for days and days on end. And as we know today, that particular piece of legislation has been approved, the AWACS sale. Let us see how the New York Times talks about that and how it presents it in a picture. We have on the front page of the New York Times today a very interesting double photograph. We have three of our senior senators looking at a score sheet, and then beneath it we have a detailed picture of that score sheet. What does that tell us? We are told in the adjoining column of who is switching, what is going to be the vote, how many votes there are, and the entire story is one almost as if we are talking about a golf card score. It's almost as if we're discussing the World Series. This is a game. Will he switch or won't he switch, you see? And what is he using or what isn't he using in this particular thing? On an inner column, we have one of the Times' serious analysts, Hedrick Smith, saying, in terms of the vote coming up, will the Times, or rather, will the president maintain momentum? Again, a sporting metaphor. The entire issue is presented in terms of votes, vote switching. What will a representative or a senator do? Why will the vote switch? If the vote switches, will there be any momentum maintained, and all the rest of this? And then finally, there is a mention in still a third article in the same issue on how one particular senator had his vote switched because highly classified information was made available to that senator. We are not told what that highly classified information is. So we come out of this tremendous news story, which on the penultimate day of the passage of the legislation, three major stories, endless verbiage, two photographs, and what are we given? Just a tremendous amount of superficial, frothy detail of how people's votes are moving, why they're moving, aren't they moving, is there momentum, and how does the scorecard rest? What are we told about the Middle East? What are we told about the fact that the United States is the main supplier of arms in the Middle East? What are we told about the enormous amount of funds that go into this Middle Eastern operation? What are we told about the role of Saudi Arabia as a protector and as the surrogate of the role that Iran played? This, if it appears at all, appears in disjointed articles in other places, not in any central manner. So that, in a very real sense, we are given a continuous set of superficial trivialities which are supposed to give us some information. In the same day, we have still another article relating to the issue of world and peace. But this is a very interesting one. On the fifth page of the Times, which I'm not sure we have any particular picture here of, nevertheless, we are able to see, and I don't know if you can see it the way I'm holding it up, But we're given four or five tidbits about the world. We're told about the Spanish regime. We're told about the Greek regime. We're told about Great Britain. We're told about Venice. All of this at the top of the Times in about 10% of the space. And the other 80% of the space is a picture of Saks Fifth Avenue, a mannequin who is wearing evening separates, ruffles, and pleats. Again, think of your ordinary reader trying to size up world situations, and four-fifths of a page is given to Saks Fifth Avenue, ruffles, and pleats. Then, of course, we come to still another issue in the area of war and peace on this same day. We have an account of the Madrid parley of the Helsinki conference, runner-up symposium conference. And here again, where the Times might be giving us some indication of the necessities for an extra effort, an extra push, an extra way to be able to reach out and to achieve some kind of a modus vivendi with our alleged enemies and hostile forces. Here again, we get the typical Times treatment in such an article. We are told by Western sources. We are told how gloomy the prognostication is. We are told how it's highly unlikely that there will be any result. We are told always through the eyes of those most likely to take a jaundiced view of an issue that all of us should be trying to get a very different type of a point of view. And then finally, on the international scene relating to peace, we might also note that on page 14 of the same issue, we have a little bit of an account of the attempt to come to an agreement on a new Secretary General for the United Nations. And on this particular account, we are told by the New York Times correspondent for the United Nations, who, when using the word conduit, that would be too good a term to describe the role of this particular correspondent. The New York Times United Nations correspondent is practically on the payroll of the United States UN delegation. This particular story indicates that one of the individuals who is in the running for the position of Secretary General cannot conceivably be considered because the United States regards that individual as, quote, too Marxist, too independent, and much, much too out of anybody's control. This, of course, seemed to be fine criteria for an individual who might be, at least in some respects, a good Secretary General. Now let's turn to one last quick article in terms of standard of living questions. And let's see, how does the Times, and here we have a long, rich historical record which doesn't have to come only out of October 28th, how does it treat our labor population? How does it treat our working population? On October 27th, the day before today, there was a very small article on page 18, mind you, on page 18, describing the possibility of a general strike in Philadelphia to defend the rights of the teachers. This is on page 18 in a relatively small article. Today's paper, on even a lesser type of an article, in a much, much more obscure part of the paper, we find that on page 16, we get a tiny box saying that a general strike has been averted, and with no real indication that this has been a tremendous victory for organized labor in Philadelphia, coming at a time when organized labor is under tremendous pressure from a very powerful type of anti-labor administration. So here we have the recurring themes that we'll be coming back to in all of the remaining sessions, and I hope in much more detail, because today was much more introductory. What we will be talking about is how are the vital interests of our people, the vital interests of our working people, the vital interests of our nation and of all nations who are trying to avoid nuclear destruction, how are they handled by the most powerful instrument of the media, the New York Times? And I'm sure we will find that they are not being handled, they're being mangled.
Doesn't go out.